You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Bill DeLuca here for The Power of Masks. Welcome to our seventh broadcast. Actually, this is our eighth. Sorry, we're in our second half of the course already. I told my students that it would go pretty quickly. And we've already looked at the use of ritual masks, performance masks, psychological masks that you and I use every day. Tonight, we're going to look at how the arts and literature have used the mask and are still using it quite a lot. So very unique take on masking that we're going through tonight. So 1-800-339-1193 gets you right here to our studio. Feel free to use that and ask a question or make a comment. We'd love to have some interaction with you, or you may want to type it onto askdhtv@gmail.com, and I can bring it up here in the monitors and conduct something of a dialogue with you on the mask. So some announcements. I just want my students to be aware that, yes, we're coming to the final finish here. So this week, your fifth discussion board is looking at this chapter 6 on the arts and literature. Sunday, though, I just want to warn you, we're going to look at Twelfth Night. Please be aware that you're not going to need to know every word in this, and don't get confused by it. We're looking at how the characters are masks in the play. So it read for the larger picture. Think character as you read the play. But we'll take a good look at it on Sunday, and then on next Tuesday, a week from now, we're going to look at V for Vendetta. So hopefully you can either get Netflix and be able to see this movie that was quite popular but has a very interesting political theme and a wonderful use of a mask. So if you haven't seen it, I hope you'll look forward to seeing that this week. Okay, just to get us going in terms of a dialogue here, I usually offer a focus question, and tonight I'd like to ask you, why do you think African masks should capture the imagination of Western artists? We're going to talk about how sculptors and painters in the West were fascinated by African masks, and some say that it helped motivate the movement towards what we now call modern art. So why do you think that was? What about African masks may have brought their fascination? So that'll be a focus question. But again, feel free to ask any question or make any comment regarding the use of masks in the arts and in literature tonight. But that's a good focus question to help you through. The other announcement I have to make, though, is that our final paper is coming up next week. So Thursday, what is that, June 14th is when we're going to be submitting the actual paper, which also serves as your final speech. So at the end of the broadcast tonight, I would like to talk a little bit more about what should go into that, because it takes time to do this paper. It is a research paper. So hopefully you're already working on it. But tonight, if you're not, maybe this will get you jump started. Okay, so let's talk about the mask and the arts. There's in our first chapter, we've actually heard Walter Sorrell talk about that the mask is kind of a fascination for us, in that the world is full of masks and we are all mask makers. That's Walter Sorrell, which of course we all know that very well, because we've just done the persona exercise where we looked at people who we know who use masks quite a lot. But Sorrell hints at why masks should be so fascinating, and Western artists, Eastern artists, have always been fascinated by the human face. So naturally, the mask would also serve as well. In fact, Jamie Shalek mentioned in her book that The face is a portrait of the character within. I don't know if you would all agree with her on that, that somehow the actual face that we have does say who we are inside. It is a statement of our inner persona by the look of what you see outside. Of course, I'm coming as a stage director, so I know, for instance, how actors, when they want to create the sense of a character who is a very analytical person, maybe they're playing Sherlock Holmes in some character like Sherlock Holmes in a show, they will make their eyebrows very bushy and try to make the makeup so that the eyes look deep set and give a great kind of depth, width to the nose, accentuate the forehead, the same way we looked at some of those Bapende masks with the accentuated forehead of the ancestors. There is some facial features that convey the the soul inside. So Shalik has an interesting point. I don't know if you would necessarily agree with it. That could be a sub-focus question for tonight. But why artists would be so fascinated with masks is a fascination in itself. And as Sorel has also said, it represents our desire to know who we are. And to some extent, even though we think of artists as people who are either painting a picture or creating a sculpture or doing a dance because they're trying to express something they feel, that's true. Obviously, that is a great motivator in artistic expression. But also, an artist represents something bigger and is a community spokesperson or movement person in that they are doing something of a shamanistic activity in representing the community, in being able to help us understand who we are. I've said a lot in my classes that theater is a mirror. You basically are giving the audience a chance to see themselves. They are looking at a play, yes, but at the same time, they are looking at their own lives on stage. Even in the strangest of restoration comedies, there is still a very close individual and group reflection that happens. So there's no doubt that artists would find masks inventive. In fact, the painters and the sculptors have found it very inventive. Let's look a little bit at the mask in painting and sculpture. This is actually a famous painting by Giovanni Tiepolo. Tiepolo loved to paint the gaiety of living in Venice in the 18th century. And if we can get a close-up on this, you'll see that they're dancing. It's called the minuet. They're doing the minuet, but they have masks on. So whenever there has been the social custom of being fashionable and going to the gambling casinos, let's say in Venice, you would wear a mask so that you would not be found out who you were. But painters' canvases have often reflected that world of gaiety and fun. And not only Tiepolo, but Watteau in France was very popular with that. Many of the other Venetian painters like Longhi and Guardi. So the mask can be used as a kind of party instrument, if you will, not just an instrument for ritual. However, there have been many artists, painters, who have used it for the more grotesque side of human life. And some have used it to perhaps show a darker side of the human experience. Bosch, Bruegel, Matthias Grunewald, who did the Isenheim altarpiece, really created a kind of carnival-like world in many of their mask characters. But James Sidney Ensor is one that just brings out a lot of what I'm talking about in terms of this grotesquerie. Ensor did a famous painting called Intrigue in 1911. And Ensor was one who felt that a mask could really be used as a psychological reflection. He was a Flemish painter, but he had this compulsive preoccupation with the mask because he found that man's inner angst could be portrayed through the use of a mask. And he did it in very unique ways. We have an image of one of his paintings here called Intrigue, and it kind of shows these people who are all in a very strange alignment. I guess we don't have that image, but his sister, oh, there it is. His sister, whose name was Mariette, was going to marry a Chinese man. Now, this is in the middle of Ostend in Belgium, beginning of the 20th century, and a lot of people in the town found it upsetting that she would marry someone from Asia. At that time, of course, we were not as accepting of other cultures as we are today. And the kind of bias and prejudice and comments that she had to face, he put into the painting. He wanted to reflect the kind of grotesqueness of these people, which was a personal story, but at the same time, it was a portrait of prejudice itself. I think if we get a little close-up of this image, you'll see that some of the characters are, all the characters are masked. So the mask becomes a way of reflecting the kind of grim inner self of these people who found it so upsetting that she was marrying outside of her cult, right? he was not famous for being a portrait painter because he felt that his whole approach to painting had to do with painting the inner character and bringing that out in a mask-like image. So yeah, James Sidney Ensor, good topic for a final paper if anybody's so interested. Okay, we're looking at masks tonight as they've been used as actors, so feel free to comment. I want to talk about the influence of African masks on painters. So if anyone has a take on that idea, why should African masks capture our imaginations in the West so much, feel free to log that in either or call it in. But the Fauves were a group of painters who were perhaps the first to really state a fascination with African masks. In 1904, Vlaminck, who was a painter who had some friends named Picasso and Durin and Matisse, in 1904, evidently they witnessed these two West African statues in a bistro and they bought them and they talked about them a lot and became a source of fascination. Vlaminck said that they were amazingly, frighteningly expressive. So the fact that they were fascinated by them said that they were going to somehow be influenced by this kind of bold simplicity that we saw when we looked at African masks. The Fauves actually dedicated themselves to returning to naked simplicity. That's what their intention was, to avoid a lot of the trappings of what the Renaissance had brought in with perspective painting. So it was something of a reaction against. Many of the artists at the time were trying to try new things. So for instance, Antoine Pevsner did a wonderful painting of what he called a celluloid metal mask. And very interesting image, if we can bring that celluloid and metal mask image up there. It shows, that's that is a good mask, but there's one that is 001.BMT that shows a mask that's actually made out of celluloid. Pevsner was very influenced by the use of film in the day, so he wanted to make one out of actual celluloid. Paul Klee did one called An Actor's Mask, 1924, and Klee wrote about how primitive children have this power to see. And so his image was very beautifully drawn, quite colorful. Marcel Duchamp had an image that was the nude descending the stair. Do we have Marcel Duchamp's image, 003.BMP.003? Duchamp's 1904 nude descending the stair was a very pivotal painting because it showed a kind of sense of movement itself. You couldn't see a particular figure in it. But yes, nude descending a stair was an attempt to show a sense of movement itself being portrayed. Also, it's important to realize that a lot of these painters were trying to react against what had been the established norm of the time, which was realism. Now, realism, if you look at a painting like The Stonebreakers by Courbet, you see a painting that looks like it's a picture. It looks like a photograph was taken. I think we have an image of that, right? The Stonebreakers, can we bring that up, the Courbet image of The Stonebreakers? I don't know. Oh, there it is. Great. Now, this almost looks like you are just witnessing two people who are working in the field. There's the daguerreotype was created in the 1840s, and this is a painting from like the 1850s, 1860s. So painting began to want to really create a sense of realism. And in theater, realism became a new form as well. But by the time the Impressionists and the Expressionists came into town, 1880s, they wanted to capture something entirely different. So I don't know if we have that Marcel Duchamp image, the 003 of nude descending the stair, but that was representative of the desire to break away from this kind of realism. Also, at the same time that artists were looking for new forms to use to convey a kind of anti-realistic approach, something that is more based in feeling, something that is not just showing our materialism, but showing, one of the famous writers, Apollinaire, said that you can't really show the truth if you're doing it through realism. The truth is something that's inside us. It's of the spirit. So it has to be more abstract. It has to have more expression to it. Interesting that the majority of our masks that we've looked at in Africa are expressionistic masks. So at the same time, there are anthropologists who are now sending unique objects back to Europe to be viewed at places like the Brussels Exposition Universelle, which showed a Congolese exhibit. I think we have some images of some of these artifacts being shown. There's one of articles from the Congo. There's a Tahitian pavilion that was done in 1900 in Paris that shows items from the South Seas. And it's a very odd collection of different curios. There's also one called the Kanaka Village, which was done at the Paris Exposition in 1889. This is an engraving from Le Monde, and it's the first time that oceanic objects were able to be viewed in their proper setting. But in reality, it was almost like a chance for people to go to Disneyland. It was perhaps the first Disneyland. So you could kind of gawk at a lot of these items, and many of them were masks as well. But it did help a lot of these artists to get new visions of the kind of work that was being done in what became known as the third world countries. And they did see a certain simplicity there that was very powerful. So a lot of these anthropological explorations also helped these artists like Picasso to get a whole new take. In fact, there's an image in Picasso's studio of Guillaume Apollinaire with a tiki figure. Do you have that image of Apollinaire in Picasso's studio? That's the Lone Ranger, but yeah, I guess we're a little off on our numbers tonight, but there's a tiki figure that Picasso actually bought from the Marquesas Islands, which became a source of inspiration for him because of the actual shapes of this. So, but most importantly, perhaps, is the painting Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, which, for those of you who have read our chapter, you know that the very first image here is of that painting. Maybe we should bring this image up if you don't have that on the slides so that we can show the students this image here on my computer. But Les Demoiselles was, this is the ladies of D'Avignon, all right? And this is not something that you could say are some beautiful women. Picasso had a special approach towards portraying these women, and it certainly shows the influence of his fascination with African masks. Some of these faces look like the Don masks that we studied from Liberia and West Africa. Some are very distorted into a highly abstract shape, but many of these look like West African masks. So, but notice too that the entire bodies have the same kind of feature. So many believe that these early explorations into masks in Africa caused people like Picasso to develop what he called cubism, the idea of breaking down this smooth body that Renaissance artists actually studied to put it into perfect perspective. But what he wanted to show was something dangerous, something that was breaking apart. And a lot of this has to do with the insanity of the times. What went into World War I had a lot to do with Europe marching into Africa at the end of the 19th century and colonizing Africa, basically taking the raw materials now rather than slaves. But a lot of artists begin to make a statement with their art about what they felt was happening in the world. And Picasso, who would later go on and paint Guernica and many other cubist paintings that stylistically showed a world that was literally breaking apart. So you have edges in Les Demoiselles that are dangerous, edges you could get cut on. They're mostly triangles in the painting. So this is a big move away from the realism, the smoothness, the absolute ratio of perfect perspective that we've seen since the Renaissance. So it was a major revolution in terms of art. And it's interesting how African masks became an influence on that. I think we have an image of the profile from Les Demoiselles. And yes, this is a great look at one of those images from the painting next to a Don mask. Right now, this is very interesting how many people thought that Picasso was basically using Don masks, although the Don mask supposedly didn't get to Europe till after World War I, but there are many other masks that could have been his inspiration. So, but you can see that kind of connection. But Picasso was very upfront about admitting how his study of African masks influenced him. For instance, there's a Gribo mask that he looked at, which helped him to learn about how a projected image could also be receding. This is his guitar study here on the one side. And in there, you can see the same kind of projectile of these Gribo mask eyes, where you can have something that is both receding and protruding at the same time. Picasso admitted that and admitted that it helped very much in his development of cubism. Many other studies that Picasso did showed this kind of influence. It's there in his Woman's Head from 1908. We're going to go through these images if we can go kind of quickly here. There's an image here of a woman's head that is a study that he did. There's one. There's another one that shows a fang mask from the Cameroon. We go to the next one, please, that shows a horse head. Yes, down in here, this is actually a headdress that was used by the ballet people, and this is a horse head that Picasso made for the Joffrey Ballet. So very interesting connections there. And other artists like Henri Matisse were fascinated by African masks as well. Matisse did a portrait of his own wife, which I hope his wife doesn't look like this, but I think you can see in this next image the influence of African masks, because this very similar Punu mask that he uses for the face of Mrs. Matisse shows that fascination. The whole shape of the eye, that symmetry, that whole chalky kind of coloration. So Matisse later became kind of an authority on African masks as well. And he believed, even when you look at one of his figures, one of his drawings, as we have one coming up, that there was a childlike simplicity that Matisse wanted to create. Oh, actually, this shows you a Punu mask right next to his wife. So you can see the similarities there. But when Matisse did a image of the human body, as he did in this this next figure, this Henri Matisse figure. Can we go to the next slide, This very childlike simplicity. No longer did they want to create the human body in a kind of realistic way. They wanted to show more of a kind of fun-like freedom in terms of that expression. And many felt that they were going back to a kind of childhood. There's a Bambara headdress across from a Brancusi sculpture that you can see the similarities in this. Amedeo Modigliani did a head in 1911 that must have had some strong influence from Africa. In this next image, we'll see that Modigliani has a, see the long elongation of the nose? Now, we've seen elongated faces and long nose as well, but nothing like this. So these artists were taking the idea and really running with it, really exaggerating their works. It almost gave them a kind of freedom to move away from just realistic portraiture. Modigliani had a nude figure that also shows a little bit of the childlike simplicity. Can we go to the next slide, which has the nude figure? Yes, and this is wonderfully simplistic, if you will. This was shocking at the time that a great artist would paint something that was so simple. But that was the idea here, to react against the kind of heavy handling of the human body and to not weight it down so much with realistic detailing, but to give it more of its inner spirit. And Modigliani does that quite well. Carlo Cara also did a number of compositions of female figures. This next one is a tempera on cardboard. And although Cara did not feel that he was copying African masks at all, in fact, he felt that they were kind of barbaric and would not be influenced, you have to admit that there's some interesting similarities. This next image will show you a fang mast right next to Cara's head of a young girl, 1911. So you can see there's a lot of similarity with the clearly delineated lines of the eyebrows and the whole arches there, the long nose, what came to be known as the slice of brie nose. interesting how much influence was there. And Emil Nold, who we were mentioning at first, was a very unique German expressionist. He actually did an exhibition of his own work before 1921. And this exhibition of Nold's work at the Folkwang Museum shows a kind of still life with oceanic tribal objects. Do we have that image of the exhibition of Nold's works? Can we bring up that next slide there, or the still life of masks? Yeah, here it is, an exhibit which has his images on the wall, his paintings are on the wall, but in between them are actual oceanic tribal objects, carvings. So he clearly wanted to show his indebtedness to his studies of Asian Pacific masks. In fact, Nold did a rather unique canvas called The Missionary. Oh, actually, there was one here called Still Life of Masks. Can we bring that one up? Yes. This is a unique study, just to show you how Nold was so fascinated with masks. The second and third are from Europe. The third one is actually from the South Pacific, and the other two are Nigerian. So he wanted to kind of create the world of masks, if you will, in one painting. So obviously he was fascinated with it, and he used masks as well in The Missionary. The Missionary is a portrait in 1912 that was rather a unique image. He used a Korean idol. That's the missionary mask there. And there's a bongo mask in the background, kind of looking on with horror at what's going on. And go back to that original image for a minute. What's happening is there's a native woman who is kneeling down with her child on her back. So, and this is only 1912, but a lot of what Nold was saying is that in Nigeria, as well as in many places in Africa, the indigenous tribal cultures were starting to become extinct because of the colonization of Africa by Britain, by France, by every European country was there. So it was a political statement against this kind of submission of African peoples to European ways. Very ahead of its time. I mean, it wasn't really until the 60s and the independence movement in Africa that many of these countries moved away from the European colonizers, but this was way ahead of its time to be able to make that statement about what was happening in Africa. So yeah, The Missionary by Emil Nold, a very good example of the influence of masks. I think we have some students here who are responding to our focus question about what may have been the influence from these African masks for some of these painters. And I see Shauna has started us off here. Thank you, Shauna. The primitive nature depicted in African masks represented raw sensuality and emotions in contrast to the refinement of European art and culture of the time. Shauna, that's wonderful. The contrast there of bringing sensuality and emotions rather than just refinement. That is very accurate because a lot of the artists were reacting against being called in to do a painting of some rich person standing by their mantelpiece and somehow showing that because of all the money they have also cultural refinement. Well, a lot of these artists want to get back to the feeling of theater, of all of the arts. Many theater artists at the same time were creating works that were mesmerizing audiences, use of scrim in the front so that you would see a kind of ghost-like image. So moving away from our dependence on realism. But I like how you put it, that it was a reaction against the refinement of European artistic styles to get back to something that was more sensitive, more alive. So it was a wake-up call. And it would last the whole century. It's interesting how African masks would become an inspiration for many artists throughout the entire century. Thanks, Shauna. Thanks for starting us off there. And here's Monda. African masks capture the fascination of Western artists because their imagery influences abstract lines, shapes, and colors rather than focusing on realistic representation. And remember, Monda, we talked about in Africa how we have very little naturalism in the masks. They're mostly expressionistic, leaning towards abstraction. So what you're saying is the imagery influences more abstract lines, creation of something that is of another world. And that's the divinity, perhaps, that African masks were calling to, and many of these artists were touched by that spirit. What was it Picasso said? Picasso had a great quote. He said something about, if we give form to these spirits, we become free. In other words, he felt that he was connecting with African spirits, and he was allowing himself to free himself from the bonds of wanting to paint just, you know, refined realism. So it was quite a unique, almost spiritual journey for a lot of these artists. Thank you, Monda. That was great. And Daphne is here too. Thanks, Daphne. Perhaps African masks were so popular because Africans and their masks looked diametrically different than the person who didn't live in Africa and therefore hadn't seen many Africans. Well, that is absolutely true. at the same time in America, it's not a very complimentary thing to say, perhaps, but people in the North had not seen black people, so they went in droves to see minstrel shows. Minstrel shows where white performers would blacken up their face and create the most exaggerated images of African Americans. That was like the first time they got to see someone who was black, but it really wasn't black. Later on, African Americans began to perform in the minstrel shows doing the same kind of exaggerated characters. So the fascination of being at least seeing people who were so different obviously added quite a lot. So that's a very good point, Daphne. It created that fascination as well. Seems like we always are so interested in the other side. No matter how straight a line we walk, we're always looking to see, what's happening over there. So I think that's a great point, Daphne. And here's Suzanne. After the Renaissance, artists wanted to express imagination and personal expression. Yes, and underline personal expression as well, because many of these great artists like Manet and Degas, some of the great impressionists, some of the expressionists like Van Gogh and Vlaminck, they had something they wanted to say, obviously in paint. So it was a personal expression as well, and that's important to remember here. Primitive sculptures helped to do this and free Western artists from past constraints. They were a way of expressing the soul inside. I like that, Suzanne. That was very good. Is there more to Suzanne's? A way of expressing the soul inside. A lot of the theater artists at the time were creating their own manifestos. They were like writing 20-page documents to say, this is what theater should be. So we have the Dadaists and the Futurists and the Symbolists and the Expressionists. It's the beginning of the 20th century was filled with all these new stylistic approaches to how we should do theater and art as well. For instance, constructivism was a visual painter's concept, sculptors as well, but there was constructivist theater as well. So a lot of these artistic styles intermingled in the world of painting, sculpture, and theater as well. But yes, the idea of dedicating yourself to a newer reality and a deeper reality that is of the soul rather than just of the materialism that we see around us. And much of this was influenced strongly by World War I, the idea of being able to blow people apart now or use gas to kill millions in the trenches of Germany and France, just seemed to be an amazing loss of life that inspired a lot of anti-war sentiments from the artists of the time. Robert is here too. How does one get a sense of spirituality or soul from Picasso's primitivism or cubism? I don't get it. I'm into impressionism and expressionism, but I don't get the other. I don't know, Robert, take a good look at Guernica, which was when the Spanish fascist bombed that town, and Picasso was attempting to show the kind of distortion and the kind of disruption that was created there. Why not let a canvas reflect what's really going on? After all, the people in power have often used the arts to reflect a world that is, you know, proper and everything is fine. My gosh, the Roman emperors did that wonderfully. So did Louis XIV and many others. So here were artists who were revolutionaries. I mean, perhaps that's the thing that people didn't get, and quite understandably, because people were so surprised to see that this guy, Picasso, who's got this wonderful town, why would he choose to paint like this? It seems like he's angry. Yeah. Yes, he was very angry. And many of them were. So to express feeling and to get your audience upset, yes, people who are paying money for their tickets will be upset about that, but that has provided some very new and very popular ways of doing theater and the arts in the 20th century. Some would say that without some of these revolutionary artists at the beginning of the century, we wouldn't have things like the American musical. A lot of forms that we now enjoy have developed right from some of these very revolutionary ideas. So I don't know, it takes getting used to, I'll admit. It's not something you can easily just say, oh, I like that painting. No, you should be upset by that painting, and that was the intention in the artist in painting it. And sometimes that's hard to relegate, I know. In fact, at the time, at the Cabaret Voltaire, which was in Zurich, many of these artists would get together to read their poems and play jazz and do pantomimes, and many masks were used. So, for instance, Marcel Janco created a mask in 1919. I think we have an image of it here that the dancers would use in these performances. Do we have that Marcel Janco mask? Yeah, this is a great mask, quite beautifully done. It was done for the dancers. But what they were doing at the Cabaret Voltaire was complaining about the silly war that was going on in France and Germany, and finding ways that they could express their contempt for what was going on in their art. So this was quite an interesting expression of that in a mask. I think we have Emil Nold's Last Supper, 1909, which also shows mask-like characters, even though it's set into a story of biblical proportions. And Alfred Stieglitz in America got on board at the beginning of the 20th century by putting on an exhibit which he labeled African Savages, the First Futurists. Futurism was one of these famous isms here, but to call them savages at the time, of course, people didn't object to that, but in time we get the whole concept of primitivism. And primitivism is a unique term here, because as Stieglitz used it, he was trying to say this is something very new, very exciting. Picasso and Jean Miró, who was a surrealist, actually said, we are trying to discover the religious essence that of primitive peoples, that they really believe, these artists, that primitive peoples possessed something that had power that was no longer available to artists, and that's what they wanted to learn. So primitivism became a term that the artists liked to use for the kind of power and simplicity and boldness that they wanted to now show, but scholars, writers, found it a little condescending, that you would be kind of putting a whole group of people from developing lands into a term that seemed to meant that it wasn't skilled. So interesting debate both ways that lasted for many years, but we don't really call it primitivism that much anymore. But obviously you can see the influence that this had. Many other artists, Max Ernst, became fascinated with Southwest Kachinas. He actually moved from Germany and came to Arizona to study Kachinas and paint them. There he is with his Kachina collection in Arizona. In fact, he even described himself as a bird-headed figure based on what his studies of Indian mythology and imagery had drawn him to. I think we have an image of his whole Zuni Kachina. This is from his collection. Yes, this is one of his Kachina images. So the world was opening up, and artists wanted to see things that they had never seen before, and their reactions to them were very unique. Marsden Hartley did a whole painting called Indian Fantasy, which obviously shows the influence of the Southwest tribes that he had visited as well. And he said, actually, an interesting thing that he had written to Stieglitz. He said that we can learn from these mighty children. I mean, he wasn't attempting to put them down as less than us, but the childlike quality is what they wanted to get back to. They didn't want to establish themselves as being better than the other person. They didn't want to be towering over someone as an adult. They wanted to get back down to a level where they could appreciate and really draw from something that was a stronger spiritual source. Henry Moore, one of the most unique sculptors of our time, was also fascinated with African masks. If you look at one of his sculptures, like King and Queen, which he did in 1952, you'll see it in this bronze. this is about the closest that Henry Moore has ever gotten to creating images that you could say, oh, that's a man and that's a woman sitting there. strange version. Obviously, this would fit into our expressionistic category in Africa. But Moore had an encyclopedic knowledge of sculpture, and he felt that realism was a small fraction of the whole history of sculpture, and that he felt sculpture had always been and will always be abstract, that the idea of doing a sculpture, and his sculptures really look like huge bones. Some of them are like huge bronze constructions that might be three stories high in front of some office building, but wonderfully ornate, but powerfully simple images that look like hip bones or whatever. But that's probably the closest he'll get to a human figure in his King and Queen portrait. But yes, he loved, as he called it, the bulky, powerful, and solid sculptures that came out of Africa. And became quite an authority on African art. So he was, like Picasso, quite open to how influential they were on his work. I think we have some sketches from his notebook, from some of these images. Yes, and many other artists, Rufino Tamayo, who was in South America doing wonderful paintings that involved masks like Carnival and Masque Rouge, showed a lot of his visual representations of fertility. Francisco Toledo also did a lot of mask work with wonderful watercolors as well. This is like in the 1960s. And I'll finish our look at the painters and sculptures here with a unique work by Robert Armin, who was a French sculptor. And in 1972, he did a piece called Accumulation of Souls. Now, Armin liked to do accumulations. He gathered together many objects and would arrange them in a certain way. Now, look what he did here. I don't know if you can recognize this from seeing it, but these are all Don masks. Now, they're not actual Don masks because he had to kind of recreate them, since this this whole polyester block is 11 feet wide, but it's like 20 feet tall. So imagine, you're half the size as you're looking at this thing. So these masks are not actual masks. They're much larger than life. But it is meant to convey a feeling. It is not a realistic portrait of someone that you might recognize from history. It is meant to ask you, how do you feel about this? What does this do for you? A lot of what these artists were trying to do was to, again, put a mirror up and let you look at yourself and experience something, so that it wasn't just learning how it fits into this whole refinement of European arts. It was more elemental than that. It was more basic. So if you get a macabre sense of the other world, the afterworld, the underworld perhaps, an accumulation of souls, that may be absolutely right. It's similar to what we're going to look at with Minister's Black Veil, when to some extent you're asked to think about it yourself and come up with your own take. A lot of artists felt that their job is not to just deliver a hard message and conclude what you should know. Their job is to ask an audience to engage and do some thinking on their own. So very provocative way, perhaps, of looking at this. I think maybe we should take a break here, because I want to come back and look at the influence of dance on the mask. And I think what I'd like to do is also ask you to think about something else. I had a number of discussion board postings on the Minister's Black Veil, so I'd like to ask you a question that you could think about during the break, and then come back and we can talk about it. But what was Hooper's intention in wearing the veil? When we talk about this, Hawthorne's short story, there's a pastor who all of a sudden, one day, puts on a veil. And how the town reacts to it and how he goes about the rest of his life with this veil is very much the subject of the Minister's Black Veil. So that's our focus question. Why do you think he even put this on in the first place? Was there some intention in his doing this? So what was Hooper's intention in wearing the veil? And I see we have Barbara here. We'll finish with a little comment from Barbara on this question that we had about the arts. Barbara said, he also painted women's anguish, which came out as cubism. I like that, women's anguish. And that is very true in Les Demoiselles. Glad you saw that, Barbara. Which came out as cubism, at how he was emotionally torturing them into breaking up with him because he could not leave his woman, Dora Maar and Maria Therese specifically. That's very good, yes. Picasso was a character in many ways. He belongs on his canvases for sure. So the torment that he may have caused for these poor women is there as well. Very good, Barbara. Thank you for including that. And Penny is also adding, you keep using the word arts and theater in concert with masks. Music, genre, and composition changed a lot in the last century. Do you include music as a genre with masking? Yes, in fact, I've had papers that show the use of masking in symphonies, in compositions. So I think there is a style, and that's perhaps what we did get from African masks, is how the different styles from the different tribes convey a certain kind of spiritual weight, if you will. And I'm saying music can do that same thing. So yes, there are masks involved in music. I should have a section, you're right, Penny, on music. Barbara is back saying, the Spanish government commissioned Picasso to paint Guernica depicting an unarmed, defenseless town assaulted with provocation. Hence, the body parts and broken animals were realistic. Ah, that's an interesting way of saying it. Frida Kahlo talked about how she was a realist because she painted what was really inside her. Now, if you know Frida Kahlo's work at all, she's quite as expressionistic as Picasso was in Guernica. So the images of these arms and the whole distortion was showing a portrait of what happened, but it was very much through Picasso's eyes, certainly as Frida Kahlo was using her own wonderful perspective on who she was as she painted images like the two Fridas. Quite wonderful. I should have her in here as well. I'll have to bring an image of Frida Kahlo to support more masking for the arts. All right, well, we're going to take a short break here, but when we come back, we're going to see how dancers have used it and how some writers like Nathaniel Hawthorne have used the mask.
You're watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Travis Shannon, and I decided to come to Cal State Dominguez Hills to the Digital Media Arts program because of the small class sizes, personal one-on-one attention I receive from instructors, as well as the freedom that I have to create the projects that I want to.
California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory base and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, ncope.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org. So opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on that. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
This is student life.
I'm home right now, but... Go!
Sweet!
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi everyone, Bill DeLuca back at The Power of Masks. We've been looking at how visual artists have used the mask. Now we're going to look at how dancers have used it, and later on about writers as well. So feel free to join us tonight. We've had a couple of interesting responses about why Western artists would be so fascinated with the mask. But tonight, let's look at this for the second half. What was Hooper's intention in wearing the veil in The Minister's Black Veil by Nathaniel Hawthorne? And we'll get to that in just a minute. But first we'll look at dance in the mask. But yeah, feel free to call us if you want to have a conversation about this. There's our toll-free number, 1-800-339-1193, or join Shauna and Manda and Daphne and Robert and Barbara and Penny are out there on askdhtv@gmail.com. So love to hear from you. Ruth Solomon was a very good example of dancing in masks. I think we have an image of her performing in a mask as this is her famous witch dance, so a mask is very appropriate for that. Dance, obviously, is something that we all like to do just to kind of relieve a lot of tension, and for a whole community dancing, that is very necessary as well. But as we've talked about with the shaman in the Americas, as well as the secret societies in Africa, and we're going to see in Asia, the importance of dance for a community. So even though dancers seem like they're doing it for their own self-expression and their sense of release, there's actually quite a social purpose that's achieved in a masked dancer. So yes, the kind of continuance that we've looked at in terms of the social cohesion that many tribes danced for some sympathetic magic, that is there in our heritage still today. So the history of mask dancing, we know a lot of this already because we've looked at Greek dances. We know, for instance, from looking at the vases from that were left, that we have lots of images of maenads dancing. A lot of what we know about theater has to do with putting together many of these vase paintings. I think I have an image of a vase painting there with the maenads dancing. Yes, so the Greeks used loud, ecstatic revelries and many cult dances, a lot of festivals and shrines and temple dances as well. So there was a strong use of masks there, as well as in Rome. Remember, Rome created the pantomime, which was a single dancer who would change masks and tell, show mythological stories backed by a chorus who would provide musical accompaniment as well. And sometimes the scenes were from family life as well. Watson, in our textbook, talks about the fascination that audiences had with pantomime. Writers of the day remark on the skills of the performers who could make the limbs speak when the tongue is silent. Great phrase to show the work of a great pantomime. And we also have mime today, basically a silent performer. A mime uses imaginary props like Marcel Marceau does, whereas the pantomimists used actual props. What you saw David Bowie do was more of a mime in that one clip that we used. So even though dancers may not have a wooden face mask on, they still put on a face. There's still an image that goes along with the body as well. And medieval mask dances were very, very popular. There were tournaments and hunting parties that usually finished with masked balls and banquets. So a lot of uses of masks there. Fertility rites all through Europe were used. In fact, we know how the church was not too happy with that. Oh, there's an image of a Roman pantomimer there. And St. Augustine actually objected to many of these masked revels that were done by these Northern European tribes. And in fact, the Trullan Synod in 1692 banned masks. But as we know from our many discussions about it, the church kind of changed their mind and found that the mask could serve them to tell the story of the Bible. The Dance of Death is an interesting addition to this history. The Dance of Death is a reflection of what was actually going on in Europe, the 14th century. There were a number of plagues that ended up halving the population of Europe. So the dance itself, and a lot of this is commemorated by wall paintings in various places in Europe. This image right here is of a wall painting, and as you can see, death is dancing in between people from all walks of life. The point is basically that death summons all of us, and no matter if you are a priest or a maiden or a farmer, you will also follow that path. And that was on the minds of everyone in medieval times, considering the effect of the bubonic plague. Many theater plays, like Everyman, were similar to the Dance of Death in this kind of reminder of the frailty of life and our need to kind of prepare ourselves for what's coming, because life is very short. However, in the Renaissance, the mask came back as a way of kind of promoting our elegance, especially in the court of Louis XIV. It's interesting that when you went to see a full-length play, five acts of a play, in between, they would have what are called intermezzi, in between the acts of the play. And the intermezzi were spectacle. Now that we were able to do these wonderfully perspective painted scenes with fabulous costumes and the use of masks. So you would have fabulous machinery that would be able to lower a whole chorus made out as if they were sitting in a cloud singing. The intermezzi, people used to fall asleep during the regular play and wake up for the intermezzi to see the spectacle. So obviously there was strong use of masks, and a lot of it was mythological stories, so that kind of factored in very well. And what evolved out of this was what's called masks, M-A-S-Q-U-E-S, which were whole performances now. It's almost like the intermezzi became so popular that they created these spectacle-driven shows called masks. And in it, you would have the aristocracy basically dressing up and parading themselves for everyone's benefit. And one of the guys who loved to parade himself, can we bring Louis back here? Louis XIV thought himself to be a dancer. He performed in many shows. He never performed in Molière's plays. Molière was smart enough to not let him do that, but Molière wrote many plays that were sponsored by Louis XIV. But the whole development of opera and ballet came very much out of Louis's court. And the idea of glorifying yourself with these shows, these highly spectacle-driven shows, Louis would not wear a mask himself. He would want to show you his elegance. This is a famous painting of his, but it's kind of in a wide... Louis was a lot taller than this image is showing us. But he was a masker in many ways. It would supposedly take him 3 hours to get dressed in the morning, not because he was lazy, but because it was a whole kind of ritual transformation. He saw himself as the Sun King. So when he dressed, to tower over his citizens, his subjects, I should say. They weren't really of citizen value yet. And during this time, the opera became very important. Jean-Baptiste Lully tried to diminish artifice in dance and began a kind of movement to get rid of the mask. In fact, Jean-Georges Nevers called for an end to masks because he believed that the mask hides your features and it stifles your emotions. So for a dancer, he felt that it was odd to wear a mask, and many took his idea. Auguste Vestris in 1772 danced and took off his mask, and supposedly that was a major event to cause the loss of masks by dancers for many years. But modern dance has brought it back. In fact, interesting that a mask, as we mentioned the Cabaret Voltaire, a dance in masks is usually for something political in the 20th century. And just as it was for actors as well, and Bertolt Brecht, who we talked about, used masks a lot because he wanted his audiences to think about the social issues that were going on in the play and not just follow or fall in love with an individual actor and develop this whole star syndrome that our own Hollywood industry kind of relies on to sell movies. So Brecht wanted people to think about it, and many dancers also wanted to go in a new direction other than realistic portraiture. And one of them was Isadora Duncan. Isadora Duncan became a major figure in the world of dance, a major inspiration for many. And her rebellion was simply against not just everything in the past, but anything that was restrictive. At the time, women were wearing corsets, girdles, and Isadora was against anything that would be restrictive, including marriage. So she wanted to free the body. She actually went to Greece, danced at the Parthenon, wanted to take in the kind of cult feeling of a lot of the original kind of indigenous Greek dances. So she became more of a figurehead for the expression of women's freedom. And now this is the beginning of the 20th century, so the suffrage movement is aligned with this in a major way as well. She also is looking a little stout in this image. I don't know, she was a lot taller than that. Isadora Duncan believed that ballet, which was created in the court of Louis XIV, was an attempt by the aristocracy to raise themselves above everyone else, almost like a kind of arrogant gesture of superiority. She felt that dance should go back to the earth and should be on bare feet, should be in the legs. And so many dancers followed her lead in that, all the way up to people like Catherine Dunham, who went to the Caribbean and studied African dance forms in the attempt to want to document them and bring them back to life. And some say that Catherine Dunham was not just the mother of African-American dance, but that she, in a way, saved it by then bringing it to shows like Treemonisha. She actually did Broadway shows and shows like Singing in the Rain, Stormy Weather, same kind of theme, where she herself danced. So Catherine Dunham, another major figure, very much like Isadora Duncan. In between, though, we have wonderful dance experiments like the Bauhaus. The Bauhaus used costumes that you would think are from some other planet. Oskar Schlemmer and the Bauhaus was an attempt to create objects that were usable and practical, but he brought in a kind of space age design in a lot of his work, not just in terms of theater shows, but architecture and household items as well. So yes, this is a very humorous form of masking, you would say, but this was a dance that was put together with metallic masks and very padded kind of sculptural suits by Oskar Schlemmer. Mary Wigman is another major figure in the dance. Wigman used masks extensively. Again, she felt like Nold and Ensor that a mask could help reveal the inner character, the kind of inner angst that was there. Realize, too, that playwrights all over America, like Eugene O'Neill, are writing very similar stories about Americans and their fascination with anxiety or their inability to perhaps develop functional families. But Mary Wigman, who's in Germany, was really focusing on more kind of mythic themes, but she wanted to, she felt that the face, with the help of the mask, would free the body, just as we had talked about for the actor, that when an actor puts on a mask, all of a sudden they're freer to use their voice and freer to use their body. So Wigman was very, very instrumental in using masks to help create very non-realistic senses of movement. So obviously when she did the witch dance, that contributed to that. In fact, I think I have an image of her masked chorus from that dance that shows her fascination with it. Not a great image, but you can see the mask there on the full chorus. And her work, she felt that the dancer had to have a very personal relationship with the mask itself. Very similar to a no dancer in Japan, who would have to study the mask before they put it on. Other performers like Kurt Juice was a choreographer who was living and working in between World War I and World War II, right at the beginning of Hitler's rise. And Juice did a unique performance called The Green Table, which was his attempt to express not just what he was feeling, but what many were feeling about the potential of peace in our times. So he had a look at the crown heads of Europe who were kind of designing the world for us. So this is a little clip that shows a rather unique use of masks for a political reason called the Green Table. Thank you. I think you get the idea. It was a rather humorous satire of the people who are leading us in the 1920s, 1930s. So Juice was, it's actually a very interesting ballet. Juice was very interested in putting ballet and theater together. He was fascinated by storytelling. He didn't just want dance to look pretty. He wanted there to be a message. And obviously, as Brecht would say, put a mask on an actor and you're now making a political statement. So, and this is not just a one-time event. Many artists will use this well into the 60s, in fact, using masks to give a kind of political statement. And obviously, our Luis Valdez did that with Las Dos Caras del Patroncito when he uses a mask to basically satirize the opposition who were not giving the Latino farm workers or any farm workers. There were many ethnicities in the Central Valley who were experiencing quite an injustice in terms of the working conditions. So politics would make great use of the mask, both on stage and in the dance. I want to show you one more clip too, though, because obviously the woman who became known as the founder of modern dance, Martha Graham, had a wonderful kind of origins in using masks as well, because she was something of a playwright and was a storyteller who wanted to deal with mythological stories. So she did many ballets, many pieces that were based in like Greek mythology. So she actually had a Dionysius character. She had Isamu Noguchi, who was creating these wonderful Greek-like sculptures in the sets that were used in the dances. So very powerful work. There's one that she did, which she herself did at first, which is called Lamentation in 1930. And it makes use, well, I'll have her describe it, but she tells a story about how a woman was so influenced by the dance. And you'll see that it is rather an abstract dance, not a realistic one, but somehow the abstraction is what allowed this woman to have such an emotional reaction. So I'll let Martha Graham herself explain this to you in this little clip about Lamentation.
It's the tragedy that obsesses a body, and the garment that is worn is just a tube of material. But it's as though you were stretching inside your own skin. One of the first times I did it was in Brooklyn. A lady came back to me afterwards and looked at me. She had a very white face, and she had obviously been crying. And she said, "You will never know what you have done for me tonight. Thank you." And left. I asked about her later. It seemed that she had seen her child, her 9-year-old son, killed in front of her by a truck. They had made every effort to make her cry, and she was not able to cry. But when she saw Lamentation, she said she felt that grief was honorable and that it was universal and that she need not be ashamed of crying for her son. And that I remember that part, that story is a very deep story in my life. It's made me realize that there is always one person to whom you speak in the audience. One.
you get the sense that in the 1920s, not just were the Bauhaus doing all kinds of stylistic experiments, but many of these dancers, Martha Graham, later Alan Nicolai, Eric Hawkins, the experimental nature of dance in the 20th century had a lot to do with this whole new movement that came in with the artistic impulse. And perhaps it was mainly political to react against the kind of insanity that was happening around the world with now two world wars, as well as some horrible acts of genocide. I mean, it seemed to be artists were reacting in an honest way, even though a lot of their canvases or sculptures were making people upset because they felt that people should be upset. Interesting experimentation, and this helped develop what modern dance is today. So there's Martha Graham in one of her performances as well. I mentioned Eric Hawkins. Hawkins, who danced with Graham for many years, actually said that the mask permits the performer to transcend his own narcissism and exhibitionism and become an artist, which is quite interesting that once you have the mask on as actor or dancer, you're no longer yourself. You don't have to be concerned about what people are saying about you. And now you can actually be an artist. You can contribute something larger than yourself. So it's a wonderful comment that Eric Hawkins makes, which is perhaps another reason why the mask came back in the 20th century after it had been missing from dance for so long. I mentioned Catherine Dunham and how she had studied Caribbean dance. A lot of Native American dances among the Hopi or the Inuit or the Sioux made use of sympathetic magic, things like the ghost dance. There's Catherine Dunham. One of the most unique dances was the booger dance, which the Cherokee, despite the horrendous treatment that the Cherokee had, they had a unique healing dance that used humor in an interesting way. The booger dance was actually a portrayal of the white men that they saw around them who were rather obnoxious. So they would dress up, have an image of it here. I don't know if we have an image, but it was basically a mockery of the kind of rude nature of the white men that the Cherokee witnessed. And they would tie these huge objects to their middle and that made a large sound, and they would dance in a very kind of humorous, grotesque way. But it was satire. It was a clear act of satire, if you will, the booger dance among the Cherokee. So very interesting use of masks for healing for the Native Americans. And the Yaqui Easter dance was very unique. The actual detailing by the actor who had to dance the role of the deer, and how the Chapayecas would actually be kind of cast away by this deer, and that the deer on Easter Sunday would then kind of reign supreme. So a lot of various uses of the mask for many dancing cultures around the world. All right, well, I think we want to talk a little bit about literature, because I think my focus question on Mr. Hooper has gotten a number of students involved. This is great. I do want to talk a little bit, though, first about some of the many uses of the mask for literature. Poets have used it. The Paul Laurence Dunbar poem is an excellent example, for instance, of the use of the mask. We Wear the Mask, which he wrote in the early 20th century, was a reaction against what he saw around him. It's quite a beautiful poem, actually. It's unique the way he structured this. It's all iambic tetrameter. In other words, it's four beats every line of an iambic, which is a simple short, long, short, long, short, long, short, long statement. And it gives it a sense of kind of control in which there is something of an anger, something of a huge sense of pain that is under this poem. I'll read it since it's so short. We wear the mask that grins and lies. It hides our cheeks and shades our eyes. This debt we pay to human guile, with torn and bleeding hearts we smile and mouth with myriad subtleties. Why should the world be overwise in counting all our tears and sighs? Nay, let them only see us while we wear the mask. We smile, but O great Christ, our cries to thee from tortured souls arise. We sing, but O the clay is vile beneath our feet and long the mile. But let the world dream otherwise, we wear the mask. It's interesting in this very short poem that Dunbar repeats that phrase, we wear the mask, three times. So it is almost meant to kind of reflect a certain irony that what he saw at the time, he actually passed away before the Red Summer, when blacks who were coming back from fighting in World War I were being lynched in Mississippi in their army uniforms. So the treatment of African Americans was still severe, but those who were sharecroppers, those who were coming to the North, had to adopt a kind of false face, if I can use an Iroquois phrase, to help them to fit in. We talk about social acceptance of a mask. It's interesting that Dunbar is using this mask that grins and lies. It is a false face, as Jung would say. It is not who they truly are. They are covering, what does he say? We smile in our mask, but O great Christ, our cries to thee from tortured souls arise. This idea of having to hide inside here is a terrible reflection of the situation that he experienced. His father was actually an escaped slave, so he has kind of a unique history here. His father served in the Civil War, but what was probably most impressive to Dunbar was the Homer Plessy decision, which in 1898, I think that was, legalized segregation. In other words, America said, it's okay for the blacks to have their bathroom over there and ours over here. And education, same thing. So that the separate but equal doctrine was set in law and did not change until we get into the 1950s with Brown versus Board of Education. So it was a time of trying to not necessarily assimilate, but to somehow fit in by the use of a mask. Dunbar does it. It's interesting how Amy Lowell does a very similar thing, not too far from this time, a little later. But Amy Lowell writes a wonderful poem called Patterns. And the whole concept of patterns, in a way, is a reflection of the mask that she was forced to wear. But this is, again, during the suffrage movement. So it is a poem about the kind of hopeful liberty for women in the 1920s, before the 20s, actually. But it's kind of a poem about women's dream of escaping the boundaries that society has placed upon them. And she does it in a quite lovely way. I walk down the patterned garden paths, and all the daffodils are blowing in the bright blue squills. I walk down the patterned garden paths in my stiff brocaded gown with my powdered hair and jeweled fan. I too am a rare pattern as I wander down the garden paths. I mean, like Dunbar, she repeats that same phrase, coming down the patterned garden paths, three times in her opening stanza. So there's a kind of repetition that is accentuating a kind of life of repetition that she is leading. My dress is richly figured, and the train makes a pink and silver stain on the gravel and the thrift of the borders. Just a plate of current fashion, tripping by in high-heeled ribbon shoes. Not a softness anywhere about me, only whalebone and brocade. And I sink on a seat in the shade of a lime tree, for my passion wars against the stiff brocade. Now, at this time, women were at least wearing Edwardian dress, It had changed from the Victorian era when women were wearing these huge hoop skirts and were kind of kept separate from people by their fashion. Edwardian relaxed it a little bit, but as she's saying there, it's brocade. A woman is still kind of incarcerated in her own clothes in the mid-19-teens. When we get to the 1920s, women are going to start wearing flapper clothes, and the whole freedom for women of the 1920s is expressed beautifully in their clothes. But this is a portrait prior to the end of the First World War of what kind of imprisonment she is in society. It's also mixed with the horrible learning that her future husband has died in the war. So it's mixed in with that as well. But very unique use of a mask to portray how society has demanded that she stays in this kind of reclusive way. So Amy Lowell, very interesting use of masking by another poet. But let's look at what our short story writer, Nathaniel Hawthorne, was up to in The Minister's Black Veil. This is a wonderful short story. You know, Nathaniel Hawthorne, I don't know if anyone's read any of his work, but he was quite famous for writing The Scarlet Letter in 1850, The House of the Seven Gables in 1851. So he was pretty well known for a kind of spirit that was a little frightening, The House of Seven Gables especially, but even The Scarlet Letter had that suspenseful kind of quality. But he wrote novels, short stories, and was rather reclusive by nature. He actually became an ambassador to England, to Liverpool, because his friend Franklin Pierce became president and asked him to do that. So he had some prestige as well, I guess. But perhaps one of the most unique things about his past is that a former ancestor of his oversaw the Salem witch trials, which factors in a lot into this strange story about Reverend Hooper. After all, it starts out in a unique way, in the same way that a playwright or a screenplay writer wants to establish, have an establishing shot. Notice what Hawthorne establishes in the beginning of this story. The sexton stood in the porch of Milford Meeting House, pulling lustily at the bell rope. The old people of the village came stooping along the street. Children with bright faces tripped merrily beside their parents or mimicked a graver gait in the conscious dignity of their Sunday clothes. Spruce bachelors looked sidelong at the pretty maidens and fancied that the Sabbath sunshine made them prettier than on weekdays. When the throng had mostly streamed into the porch, the sexton began to toll the bell, keeping his eye on the Reverend Mr. Hooper's door. The first glimpse of the clergyman's figure was the signal for the bell to cease its summons. "But what has good Parson Hooper got upon his face?" cried the sexton in astonishment. And that line disturbs the peace that Hawthorne sets up in this first paragraph. Spruce bachelors looked sidelong at the pretty maidens. In other words, sidelong meaning sideways. If you were a single guy coming out of the church with your family, you didn't just look at the girls like this. You had to look out of the corner of your eye, because if your father caught you doing that at a time when we are at church, right? We're communing with the people around us. It's a sacred day. It's not a day to get a girl's phone number, right? So you were probably going to get hit in the head if you were found out. That is a very different world than we have today, yes? And a lot of what Hawthorne sets up here is this very restrictive community that is so bound by the idea that a woman, for instance, should wear black, should be in a full-length skirt. There should be no music, even at the ceremonies, even at the religious ceremonies. Theater, forget it. Realize that the Puritans, the Quakers that came over to America, the theater is where the devil reigned. So any kind of arts, painting, visual, this was taboo. So he sets this image of a very restrictive community. And certainly, the moment when people see Reverend Hooper wearing a veil sets a kind of tremor through the community. The cause of so much amazement may appear sufficiently slight. Mr. Hooper, a gentlemanly person of about 30, though still a bachelor, was dressed with due clerical neatness, as if a careful wife had starched his band and brushed the weekly dust from his Sunday's garb. There was but one thing remarkable in his appearance. Swathed about his forehead and hanging down over his face, so low as to be shaken by his breath, Mr. Hooper had on a black veil. On a nearer view, it seemed to consist of two folds of crepe, which entirely concealed his features except the mouth and chin, but probably did not intercept his sight farther than to give a darkened aspect to all living and inanimate things. Now, it's written in a style that may seem a little alien to us, but it's actually quite beautiful. Sometimes language like this, it's better if you read it out loud to get a sense of the kind of rhythms in it, varying rhythms as well. So the townspeople just freak out. I can't really feel as if good Mr. Hooper's face was behind that piece of crepe. One person believes that it's not him. I don't like it, mutters another woman. Our parson has gone mad, says another. A rumor of some unaccountable phenomenon had preceded Mr. Hooper into the meeting house. In other words, everybody was talking about it as if it was some phenomenon, right? There was a general bustle, a rustling of women's gowns, a shuffling of men's feet. I mean, it really sets the whole community into a tizzy. Such was the effect of this simple piece of crepe that more than one woman of delicate nerves was forced to leave the meeting house. Now, today, if someone wears a veil, my gosh, in Southern California, no big deal. It might add to your whole outfit. It might be a nice touch, male or female, right? But not in this particular society. This is the society of The Scarlet Letter, which was, for those of you who didn't get to read that wonderful book, The Scarlet Letter is an A that Hester Prynne has to wear on her sweater, right, to announce to the community that she's an adulterer. In other words, your sins have to be announced to everyone. So that particular book was very much at the heart of looking at a culture that would not endure any kind of weakness. So Mr. Hooper finally does now address his community, and here's how he acts in front of them. Mr. Hooper had the reputation of a good preacher, but not an energetic one. He strove to win his people heavenward by mild, persuasive influences rather than to drive them thither by the thunders of the word. The sermon which he now delivered was marked by the same characteristics of style and manner as the general series of his pulpit oratory, but there was something either in the sentiment of the discourse itself or in the imagination of the auditors which made it greatly the most powerful effort that they had ever heard from their pastor's lips. It was tinged rather more darkly than usual with the gentle gloom of Mr. Hooper's temperament. The subject had reference to secret sin and those sad mysteries which we hide from our nearest and dearest. A subtle power was breathed into his words. There was nothing terrible in what Mr. Hooper said, at least no violence, and yet, with every tremor of his melancholy voice, the hearers quaked. You know, I mean, that's a great piece of writing. The hearers quaked. It's almost hard to say that quickly. When you read it, you can kind of run by that and get the idea of what he means. But when you say it, the hearers quaked. It's you have to slow down and say it. That's good writing. Writing that is that forces you to draw focus to why is this community so upset at this man for doing this? Obviously, Hawthorne wanted to make a big splash out of how people reacted to it. And in fact, that's the whole structure of the story. The afternoon service had similar circumstances. He has to do a funeral, right? But here, it was now an appropriate emblem to have a veil on. The clergyman stepped into the room where the corpse was laid and bent over the coffin to take a last farewell of his deceased parishioner. As he stooped, The veil hung straight down from his forehead, so that if her eyelids had not been dosed forever, the dead maiden might have seen his face. So, in a way, to conduct a funeral, it's an ideal thing to wear a veil. Many women do wear black veils to a funeral. Could Mr. Hooper be fearful of her glance that he so hastily caught back the black veil? Oh, and this is great. A person who watched the interview between the dead and the living scrupled not to affirm that at the instant when the clergyman's features were disclosed, the corpse had slightly shuddered, rustling the shroud and muslin cap, though the countenance retained the composure of death. In other words, someone thought that when Reverend Hooper leaned over the corpse like that, that the corpse shuddered a little bit, came to life, or was so frightened by this image of him in his veil. You know, and this is something Hawthorne does a lot because so many writers do it a lot. They want to create, because later on in the paragraph, someone else says that they saw that moment too, and they didn't notice anything different. They didn't notice that the corpse shuddered or anything like that. And in The Scarlet Letter, when Reverend Dimmesdale, who was the one who was the adulterer too, is on the gallows getting ready to be hung for it, there's a wonderful moment in the book where Hawthorne mentions that some people who were in the audience watching the proceedings thought that they saw his coat open up with a large A on his chest. But then he says, but there were others there who didn't see anything. So why, why be so ambiguous? Why give us both sides of the story? Isn't that the art of writing, that you kind of make a strong statement? Not really. Shakespeare does it quite a lot, where he leaves it ambiguous enough so that we want to know more information. After all, what makes us watch all of our crime dramas, our Law and Order dramas, or whatever, CSI, to the end? Because a good writer takes us on a rather circuitous course. And through all of this, we should be asking, why is he doing this? Why is he wearing this veil? He has to then go and do a wedding, which is very inappropriate. In fact, at one point, Hooper raised a glass of wine to his lips, wishing happiness to the new married couple in a strain of mild pleasantry that ought to have brightened the faces of the guests like a cheerful gleam from the hearth. But at that instant, catching a glimpse of his figure in the looking glass, the black veil involved his own spirit in the horror with which it overwhelmed all others. His frame shuddered, his lips grew white, and he spilt the untested wine upon the carpet and caused him to rush forth in the darkness. So, not a good idea to get yourself married by a priest or a pastor who's going to have a black veil on his face. The next day, the whole village of Milford talked of little else than Parson Hooper's black veil. And the whole community was so upset. It's interesting that there was a moment there where they sent a couple of the elders to try to talk to him, but they were so upset that they never got to even ask him. But he did have the chance to confer with one of the more calmer characters. In fact, everything up to the first half of the story is all about the community. Now we finally get one person who's going to say, what's going on here? Why are you wearing that veil? And take it off, because this is Elizabeth, who is his fiancée. They are hoping to be together. But Hooper holds his sway. Your words are a mystery, returned the young lady. Take away the veil from them. And he says to Elizabeth, Elizabeth, I will, so far as my vow may suffer me, know that this veil is a type and symbol, and I am bound to wear it ever, both in light and darkness, in solitude and before the gaze of multitudes, and as with strangers, so with my familiar friends. No mortal eye will see it withdrawn. This dismal shade must separate me from the world. Even you, Elizabeth, can never come behind it. So Elizabeth is shocked, but calmly is able to pursue and ask him for an explanation, until finally he pleads with her, please have patience with me, Elizabeth. Do not desert me, though this veil must be between us here on earth. Be mine, and hereafter there shall be no veil over my face, no darkness between our souls. It is but a mortal veil. It is not for eternity. Oh, you know not how lonely I am and how frightened it is to be alone behind my black veil. Do not leave me in this miserable obscurity forever. I mean, he's really suffering behind this as well. It's not like he's putting it on to show off or anything. And he's certainly committed to it for his whole life, because she says, lift the veil but once and let me see your face. Never, it cannot be, replied Hooper. Then farewell, says Elizabeth. And that's it. The only person who could possibly have gotten him to take it off does not succeed. And the whole rest of the story finishes with his long effort. He does not take the veil off. The last scene is him dying. It mentions, though, that among its bad influences, the black veil had one desirable effect of making its wearer a very efficient clergyman. Dying sinners cried aloud for Mr. Hooper and would not yield their breath until he appeared, though ever, as he stooped to whisper consolation, they shuddered at the veiled face so near their own. Evidently, the darkness that he brought was of some comfort, perhaps, to many in his community, and it talks about how people went to him for confession. And then finally, on his deathbed, there is the attempt by Reverend Clark to remove it. And for a moment, we almost think that Hooper's going to allow that to happen, but then he jumps back, grabs the veil, and with a mighty effort, grasping forward with his hands, he caught hold of life and held it back till he speaks. He raised himself in bed, and there he sat, shivering with his arms of death around him, with the black veil hung down, and with a faint smile, he says, "Why do you tremble at me alone? Tremble also at each other. Have men avoided me, and women shown no pity, and children screamed and run only for my black veil? What but the mystery which it obscurely typifies has made this piece of crepe so awful? When the friend shows his inmost heart to his friend, the lover to his best beloved, when a man does not vainly shrink from the eye of his Creator, loathsomely treasuring up the secret of his sin, then deem me a monster, for the symbol beneath which I have lived and die. I look around me, and lo, on every visage a black veil." Now, these are his dying words, that he sees a black veil on every one of us. So it is a unique short story, one obviously designed by Hawthorne to make us think. And I'm curious to get some of the feedback from some of our students. We actually had on the discussion board many students who found this rather fascinating as a story. So let me share the take that many of them shared here. This is Robert Obradovich saying, "Nathaniel Hawthorne's The Minister Black Veil is an exceptionally well-written and engrossing short story." I agree with you, Robert. It may be difficult at first, but if you kind of stick with it, there's actually a kind of musicality to how it's written. I'm not much on symbolism. I tend to be a linear thinker that defaults the shortest distance between two points. But in my unusually wild flight of imagination, I see a parallel between Hawthorne's short story and The Phantom of the Opera, which is a wonderful connection. As he has pointed out in his readings, all of us tend to live behind masks that seemingly hide our deepest hurts and darkest thoughts as we yearn for love and acceptance of who and what we truly are. Just as in Phantom of the Opera, in which Christine wants to see what's behind the mask, so does Elizabeth in her exchange with Mr. Hooper. That's a terrific parallel, and it's very unique that they are so similar, those two scenes. Both Mr. Hooper and the Phantom cry out in grief at the prospect and the exposure of the painful aspects of their lives to the world. I really couldn't get past this parallel, and in the end may have missed some of the equally important aspects of Hawthorne's work. I hope some of the more intuitive types can show me the way. And then, interesting reaction that Antoinette Smith has to Robert. "I do agree with you. I found a lot of similarities between Phantom of the Opera and The Minister's Veil. It seems that the veil was hiding their past and even the disfigurement that they had." And that's an interesting way of putting it, that Reverend Hooper was somehow disfigured under the veil, just as our Phantom is, obviously, in the opera, in the musical. However, I thought the minister felt he should be treated the same as everyone else and couldn't understand people were frightened or turned off by the mask. It was an interesting read, and until he died, he did not want to remove the mask. Yeah, interesting that Antoinette mentions that he couldn't understand why people were frightened or turned off by the mask. And in fact, Amal Ibrahim has a reaction to Antoinette and says, "I really enjoyed reading your post on this discussion. I didn't see anything wrong with the minister wearing the veil, and I was rather surprised by the public's reaction to it. I guess the unknown may be a little scary, and the fact that the people were not sure why the minister was wearing the veil and what was under the veil made them scared. I also thought that the minister's veil was weird, but I also think if he wants to wear it, he should wear it. I do think that people should just try and take it off of him or beg him to take it off, or should not beg him to take it off." Interesting, Amal, that you, in a very contemporary kind of framework, don't see anything wrong with the veil. And to some extent, that makes total sense. Why would this particular society be so offended by it? Well, maybe that's what Hawthorne, as well as Reverend Hooper, is trying to say, that there's something about our living, our community, that is not quite right, that perhaps we tend to think of ourselves as forgiving Christians, but at the same time, we're not that open to each other. So there is something of a parable in this story as well. And here's April Graham O'Brien, who also found this interesting. "I found the minister's black veil very thought-provoking. The first day that Mr. Hooper wears the veil, the topic of his sermon was the people's concern for their sins and how they hide their innermost secrets from the people they love the most. The outer mask hides the genuine, imperfect human self. Since the members of the congregation felt that Mr. Hooper had discovered their hidden secrets and sinful thoughts, they segregated themselves and ostracized him for wearing the veil. They assume the veil is a symbol of sin and has a sinister purpose. As his life changes and he loses his love, Elizabeth, it becomes apparent that Mr. Hooper is punishing himself for his own hidden sins. However, he is confident that he will be freed from the veil and his sins in death. Similar to the theme of sacrifice that has been discussed several times during this class, his veil is also a symbol of sacrifice, so he will go to heaven." Interesting that you bring that up, April, that there is a kind of sacrificial action that is happening, that he would even sacrifice his relationship and marriage with Elizabeth for this veil. Okay, well, that was some of the comments on the discussion board. I see we have some students here live, at least. I'll read some of their posts here. Daphne is saying, "I am struggling with reading these supposed classics. What makes a classic writing or poem? Because I just don't get it." Well, when we say classics, we're saying from another time, and surely the way people talk in this story is of a different way of relating. The 1840s, 1850s in America did not have the kind of freedoms that we experience today. The 1960s hadn't happened, that's for sure, back then. And the classical quality here too is that there's kind of an architecture, if you will, in the story that gives it a kind of size, that it's in the same way as opera and many other forms of what we saw with Shakespeare or the Greeks, it gives it something of a more formal handling than what we have in more 20th century writers. I don't know, that's just taking a shot at helping you to deal with that, Daphne. I see Robert is here too. "Regarding Mr. Hooper, if the soul or our inner self is reflected in our face," we had mentioned in the beginning of the broadcast how Jamie Shalek had said that our faces are reflections of who we are inside. I think a lot of people disagree with that, but as I was saying, actors tend to use the face as a way of showing what the character that they're playing is really about. "If the soul of our inner self is reflected in our face, seems Mr. Hooper tried to shield his inner ugliness from his parishioners and kept his sins from becoming a model to others." That's an interesting take on that, Robert, because obviously a veil would seem to be kind of hiding something, except that he could have made it a pink veil, but he made it a black veil. And there's something about the blackness in the image that maybe he is showing that he has sinned. Maybe the veil is specifically that statement. And he's acknowledging his own mortality, vulnerability there. Remember, we talked about in hiding, you can open up, that when you put the mask on the actor, you actually get more freedom. What is it Mr. Wilde said? You know, give him a mask and he will tell the truth. So I don't know, maybe the veil can also be a symbol that he's asking the community to think, why are you hiding your sins? Maybe it's time that we are a little more openly acknowledging of who we are. I see Suzanne is here too. Great, Suzanne, thanks. The minister's black veil is obvious. He had sinned, pulling himself away from God. He donned a veil, much like Mexicans' understanding of redemptive suffering, to offer atonement for his sins and set an example to the congregation. Is there any more to that? I mean, once you are putting a veil on, it is obviously you are setting some kind of example, and perhaps he is actually being rather Christ-like in this story of setting an example for the rest of his community. And as it does say, he was a much more effective minister in doing this. Let's see, we have one more comment here from Richard. The mask makes you someone else. It allows you to become the artist. The audience doesn't know who you are. It can eliminate the ego's place. And in a way, the minister is playing a much more ministerial role. All right, well, I knew he would probably get into this in some depth, and I wanted to be able to at least give you guys a look at the writing guidelines for the paper. So please look these over, because you need to decide between the two options for your mask research paper, which is either to write about a ritual mask and to be able to analyze it, to describe it, to have a subjective response to it, and to also write your research about how it was used, or take the option, which is a little bit more creative, of taking the work of an artist or a composer. And I have many examples on my website to show you some examples of people who have written, for instance, about a film. There are many films that make use of masks, and we're going to see one next week, for instance, with V for Vendetta. But maybe some of the things that you heard about tonight, from how artists and painters and sculptors and dancers and writers have used masks. If you're interested, maybe you want to take that option number two. So, feel free to email me if you have concerns about the topic that you're going to use. But we'll look forward to talking to you on Sunday about Twelfth Night. So remember, read it for masks. Don't worry about every little word there, because it gets very complicated. We'll see you on Sunday.